I'm coming to you from Windy Carr, Colorado at the National Black-Footed Ferret Conservation Center. Hi everyone, welcome to the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service's Conservation Connect, where we connect you guys to awesome careers, exciting wildlife, and new technology that conservation professionals use to study and protect wildlife. Today, I'm here with U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service's Education Specialist, Kimberly Frazer. Kimberly, you have an amazing place. I'm seeing beautiful prairie in the background. We've got prairie dogs popping out of their holes just behind us. Some are yelling at us. Thank you for having us here in Colorado.
Well, welcome to the National Black-Footed Ferret Conservation Center. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Can you talk to me about how you got interested specifically in a career working with black-footed ferrets?
Absolutely. Well, you know, I was a child that loved nature. I loved getting outside. And an opportunity came up to volunteer right here at the Ferret Center. And I took that opportunity. And then a job came along and I applied for it and was hired. And so, you know, I think it's really important to understand that if you volunteer, it can lead to having a job of doing something that you really love, and I love black-footed ferrets.
I can tell, absolutely can tell by that. Can you talk to me about some fun and interesting facts, what you find fascinating about black-footed ferrets?
Black-footed ferrets have the longest canine teeth of any species in the world in ratio to their skull. And not only that, they're nocturnal, they're solitary, and they live their whole lives on these large, beautiful expanses of prairie.
Kimberly, I know the black-footed ferret was once thought to be completely extinct. Can you tell us how we brought them back and why they're so critically endangered still today?
Yes, well, you know, being a native species of the Great Plains, habitat loss happened around the turn of the century in 1900s, and 98% of the prairie was plowed up, so that was loss of habitat. Then they're highly susceptible to diseases on the plains, and also their food resource, prairie dogs, can be a lot, you know, there can be a problem with keeping enough on the landscape.
So Chelsea, here yes. We are outside one of the breeding room doors, and guess what's behind the door?
Are there some ferrets?
There are a lot of ferrets behind there. In fact, it's just about lunchtime. Would you like to go in and help feed them?
That sounds awesome.
Okay, great. But first we have to put on some booties and gloves and a mask.
Okay. Does this actually help us protect us from the ferrets?
No, actually it protects the ferrets from us.
Oh, you're kidding.
We don't want to take in any diseases that might affect them.
Got it. We're
okay,
ready.
Let's go.
This is exciting. You can't tell right now, but these are huge smiles on our faces.
Kimberly introduced me to Tyler, a biological technician who's responsible for making sure the ferrets are fed daily.
Hi, Tyler.
Would you like to feed them?
I would love to help feed Dottie's kits.
I even met Dottie, one of the female ferrets who had three kits, and I was given the opportunity to find out just what ferret kits ate.
Now, I know we're not supposed to say wildlife is cute, but these guys are cute.
They are cute.
Hamster. Ground horse meat.
Rat.
And rats. Although these guys are too young now, eventually all the kits will have a diet exclusively of prairie dogs.
Kimberly, that was amazing. I'm pretty sure that's going to go down as one of the highlights of my career. Thank you so much.
You are welcome.
I know we've said that black-footed ferrets are critically endangered, but how exactly do we know that? How do we know how many ferrets there are in a given area?
Well, when they're born at the Ferret Center, when they reach a certain age, we give them a pit tag, and we insert that in the back of their neck. It's about the size of a piece of rice. It's what your vet would give your cat or dog.
Like a microchip.
A microchip, yeah. So the ferrets get a pit tag, and then they're released into the wild. And then we go out on what's called spotlighting tours, looking for those ferrets with big spotlights. And when we think we found one, we run over to the burrow where they live, and we take one of these, which is actually a ring reader. You know, it's a pit tag reader,
okay. But
it's round because it fits right over the top of the burrow system.
Makes sense.
Like that. And when that ferret pops up, the pit tag is read back at the truck, and we know exactly who that ferret is.
This is incredible because it's so non-invasive. The ferret pops up, you don't have to capture it, you don't have to harm it in any way, touch it in any way, and you've got your data and information right there.
We've got the data of information of who it is, where they were born, everything about that one ferret.
Awesome. Kimberly, can you talk to us? The students watching us, I know they're in love, as I am, with black-footed ferrets. What are some things they can do to help them?
You know, it's a native species. It belongs here in North America. And I always like to tell students to learn as much as you can about our native species. You know, they belong to us as Americans, and it's just important to know what we have here in our backyards.
Kimberly, I can't begin to thank you enough for allowing all of us to get an inside scoop of seeing black-footed ferrets, seeing the kits, watching the feeding. This has been incredible for us to see.
Well, thank you for coming.
For all of you young biologists out there, be sure to check out more information about these amazing creatures. You can check out blackfootedferret.org for more information and share it with your friends and family. There actually may be opportunities to volunteer at your local National Wildlife Refuge, your nature preserve, or local park. We'll see you guys next time on a not so windy place with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service's Conservation Connect.